So yes, it has been quite a healing process to be here for the last few days already. Helene initially invited me here to talk about the hologram, which is this feminist peer-to-peer healthcare system. And I thought, yeah, that's going to be a really wholesome thing to talk about. And then Cassie was going to come. Cassie, unfortunately, isn't here. And so then I was invited to talk about blockchains for care. And I was like, no, don't make me talk about that. Blockchains are awful. But it is true that for like the last 5 or 6 years, we have been thinking about blockchains for care. And I feel comfortable enough with you all now that you won't kind of mistake our experiments with blockchain for blockchain boosterism. So that is my kind of, and the reason I'm saying this with so much kind of uncomfortable energy is because really like the last 5 or 6 years of our work with blockchain, we have constantly been told that we're blockchain boosters. And it's been quite uncomfortable. And so it's kind of, and I think it's interesting and important to kind of bear this stuff in mind. We're gonna think about whether blockchain tech can contribute to ecologies of care that are more inclusive and that allow engagement and cooperation in a non-hierarchical manner. I kind of wanna start with the work of Further Field that started back in 1996. Co-founded with Mark and I, and then really kind of co-created with distributed networks of artists, techies, and activists, trying to experiment with how we might create new art contexts that are distributed globally. Mark talked about it already, but I'm gonna say some of the same stuff in a slightly different way because I think it's kind of useful grounding. This image is image of Further Field Gallery in Finsbury Park, where we've been since 2011. This park is a kind of classic London Victorian metropolitan park. It's used, as Mark said, by people who speak over 200 different languages. It's edged by three main roads that travel in three different directions around, like taking people to different parts of the centre of London and the north and east of London, with really strong migrant flows. So we're seeing kind of populations from different parts of the world flow into different parts of London, depending on the fortunes of those communities and economies. And it's been there's been a kind of trajectory of our work since we've been in the park. We started by funneling what we believe to be the most kind of urgent and fascinating work by artists thinking about the social and environmental impact of technology, network technology specifically, into this little pavilion in the middle of a park and working out how we could connect with the other people in the park to find where our common interest was and where what shared urgencies we had. But it was really this process of kind of funneling work from an international scene into a local scene where people are bringing their kids to have ice creams or play in the park or play football or whatever. And then really over, especially in the last kind of 5 or 6 years, we started to have a sense of the communities that use this park have an awful lot to offer in the other direction. So we've been working with a variety of artists and participatory processes to work out how the users and communities of the park that we're now much more connected to can inform what we do and can shape what we do, and how we funnel their expertise either in their lived experience or subject-specific or practice-based, how we can kind of push it back out into the world. So that's been happening. And then on the right here, this image still, so we made, this is a kind of remake of an image that we made in 2006. I think Mark talked about it as well. It's the kind of DAIWO graphic. So this is a progression of the early days of net art, which was a kind of punk ethos of you take the tools, you make your own stage, play two chords is punk, three chords is jazz. You know, like, this is our culture, we're gonna claim it, this is culture. This was the early days of the net for us as artists. And then DAIWO was like this dawning, it's kind of a polemic, but it's also a dawning realization that we're like making culture together. And we're making culture together across difference and across distance, and to think of it as the work of an individual genius, which is what the art world encourages us to do, is crazy lies, capitalist lies. It's all lies. So the DAIWO, do it with others, is a kind of, it's a call to action, but it's also a call to remember, like this network of like tools, modes of being. So like, I'd like to think of this, in the top we have the philosopher, in the bottom we have the hysteric, like storage systems, other living creatures, licensing, new economic modes, and my favorite in the bottom here is the talking dildo, to remind us of the kind of libidinous energies in the network. Like early porn really powered the early days of the web. Without the kind of global sexual energy, we probably wouldn't have the web we now have. Okay, so I'm saying this because I want, like, a big part of our thinking about blockchains has been about this relationship between these two, like many, many layers actually, but we can simplify it as two layers. So the kind of digital layer and the physical layer. And what happens when these things become disconnected in our minds, or we forget how connected they are? So together, we've really learned how a net-based art context really needs to be grounded in a relationship to bodies and land and communities of people and more than human life forms sensing, being, and acting together. This is the kind of reality that we're operating in. And so I'm going to talk about why our work with the web and peer-produced decentralized digital infrastructures for art, culture, and society have kind of like how they led us into blockchain as a kind of research field, and how it's making us kind of think about our responsibilities to life in places. I have a book out last year with a collaborator, Penny Rafferty, called Radical Friends, Decentralized Autonomous Organisations in the Arts. And this is like the culmination of 5 years of research. I'm gonna do a little bit of moving backwards and forwards through time to contextualize that. But I'm gonna talk a little bit more about that book, because the focus of our blockchain work is kind of landed in this DAO, in the field of decentralized autonomous organizations. To focus on translocality, and I'm going to talk about that more now, but it's like how we organize with accountability to life in places. Okay, so that's my setup. That's what we're going to try and do. First, though, let's look at the lessons of Web 2, well, the lessons of the web. This is the happiest picture I've ever seen of Mark Zuckerberg. Why is he so happy? Well, he's moving in the world free. Everyone's distracted by the world he's just put in front of them. So they're in the cyber world. He's like swaggering about doing what he likes, and no one can really see what he's doing. And so I think that this gives us, this is like the setup for why, one of the reasons why blockchain has become like an interesting thing for us to look at. So one of the things that blockchain does is that it makes certain things, especially financial flows, more transparent. There's an awful lot of revolting stuff going on there, and we're going to talk about that some more. But there were lots of awful things that have been set up by the World Wide Web that I think we need to learn from. So I know it's ridiculous. We can't blame everything on Mark Zuckerberg, but let's just—it kind of makes it easier to think about sometimes. So let's blame Mark Zuckerberg for colonizing cultures with a one world view. Okay, so the universalizing effect of the World Wide Web, like these flattened interfaces, like trying to use the same, like very homogenized language, standardized systems, homogenized language, and all at the same time operating within capitalism. So this has delivered us all into kind of atomizing, competitive, global surveillance capitalism that's like been well understood and studied now. Shoshana Zuboff is like, I think she did a really good job on thinking about that. It's also been used to privatize what used to be public utilities of communication, transport, living, health, all kinds of things. And it's done it in a really sneaky way. Like it's done it, we haven't really seen it happening, but that's what's happening. And kind of like in different parts of the world, there's the more intense problems. It's kind of unevenly distributed, but we have an intensification of state control as well. The growth of the web, okay, so we can't say it's the cause, but I think maybe these things are connected. We've seen a growth in inequalities, xenophobia, racism, censorship, climate emergency and growth, again, very uneven distribution of oppression. And so all through our work on the web, like we were really fascinated with, and I think a lot of us share networks with artists and techies who've really done a lot of focus on critical creative practices, like that reveal power flows. Basically, they give ways to make some of the sinister actions of this world more feelable to people and to understand what's important. But I think we have a growing sense now that these are really not enough unless combined with organized struggle on the ground with people where you are as well. So I think this is like really what we want to think about. So this is like thinking about the potential of art world DAOs for care and translocal belonging. And this was the topic of my essay in the book that we put out, in The Radical Friends that we put out. And it's really to discuss the importance of DAOs to ideas of cooperation and belonging, especially in relation to place and locality. So translocality, it's a term that was termed by cultural geographers, and it helps us to think about changes to the way we think about place, people, and cultures that we belong to as a result of globalization, migration, and hyperconnectivity. It's a term that kind of really came into use in the 1990s. I think it probably has quite a few different, I think it has a few different cultural roots. So I think there's been different focuses on this term, but I think it's just generally a useful term for us to think about. And I think specifically, it describes the fact that we all live in multiple layered and interconnected localities, both physically and online. All at once. And as a result, most of us now feel that we belong to many communities in multiple places at once. And these different communities make quite conflicting demands on us. They shape our identities in new ways. They affect how we feel about work, the kind of ways that we play together. And it really makes us question where and to whom we belong. I think one of the most useful things it does for us as thinking and reflective beings is to provide a check against becoming too comfortable with the invisible violence of these universalizing digital networks. So let's actually just, we'll just think this through. I've made this kind of hodgepodge slide. But so here we are, living beings in bodies and places. And these things are also happening in different layers. So like social, political, and kind of digital layers all mixed up. If we look at this one first. So we have 67% of the population are unique mobile phone users. 63% are internet users. Let's just focus on that. So this is interesting, right? So we think definitely living where we do, it's like we assume that most people are kind of using, their lives are completely interconnected with the web. Well, that isn't true. It's not true, it's not there, there's generational unevenness, both in terms of internet use and device use. But there's also massive global variation in who has access. And so, like, just to scratch the surface of this, we can just kind of like use our imaginations and think about what this means. So what this means is that those of us who are connected to the internet and these very standard ways of using things are all being kind of conditioned to think in fairly similar ways about value, economics, and work. But the people who are outside that are still massively affected by the mass of people who are now working in these very standardized ways. So you see, you basically see this kind of action of a kind of the power of this kind of like massive consolidation of a kind of set of values and behaviors. And you can imagine how this is now kind of violating other people's autonomy who don't have access to this, who have other ways of doing culture and other ways of living. I was really surprised last year to discover that 10% of internet users, 16 to 64, own some form of currency. Cryptocurrency. I think that's like really massive. Like, it hasn't been that easy for very long to even get a wallet and get crypto. Like, it requires some technical kind of determination to do that. So I think, like, so now we have 10% of people who know enough, to be motivated to do it. And the distribution of it's quite interesting across countries. I'm presenting these things not because the facts themselves are important, but we can kind of see the, like, it gives us a useful way to think critically about how digital tech is affecting us. Okay, so this is the tech. And then on the other side of the slide, we see these kind of massive migration patterns. We also see, so we see the number of international migrants going up, and we see the migrant share of the global population shifting as well. We see the things that are pushing the migration, so persecution, violence, war, poor wages, lack of jobs, crop failure, famine, pollution, natural disaster, limited opportunities, lack of services, family separation. Many of these things are now going to are being really intensified by climate collapse, basically. So this is only going to intensify. And then there's the pulls, so there's safety and freedom. So like these are kind of symmetrical. And then in the middle, I've just put these kind of, so I put these two items that I just kind of Googled at the end of last year. So these are news stories, and we're starting to see the narratives that then get attached to these, to the statistics. So we see the UK's first climate change refugees presented as kind of like stoic survivors of flood or wind. And then we see this dog whistle racism from the Mail Online, you know, like floods of refugees, kind of classic language. And the UK, meanwhile, is trying to kind of throw up new legal and physical borders to stop people coming in. in spite of the fact that one might assert that, like, climate collapse is a result of industrialization that really started in the UK. You know, like, so where does responsibility lie? I would like to play this game a bit later. Okay, so this is, I'm putting it here because it kind of belongs in thinking about translocality. So Tai Selassie is a writer, is a British writer whose four grandparents hailed from four different continents. And the question of where she's from became a real burden to her. Like, how the hell do I answer this? And feel like it became, and she did a lot of thinking and writing about this. So she now says, don't ask me where I'm from, ask me where I'm local. And I think this is really interesting because it's going to apply to more and more of us over time. And she says the way to answer this is by asking with whom you share rituals, relationships, and restrictions. And these, the people with whom you share these things, these are the people with whom you feel like you belong. And questions of belonging are going to become really political. This isn't a cozy conversation. And sometimes you'll feel like you belong to some people, but other people that you belong to, these will not hold the same values, and there'll be conflicts and tensions. So maybe we can play this later. It's a really fun game. Like, we can think about two, like, I belong to you lot. I also belong to my family, and there's tensions there. We share very different kind of rituals and restrictions. Okay, so, this is just to give some sense of how the research has happened at Further Field. So back in 2014, one of our most regular and favorite writers and artists and developers, Rhea Myers, wrote this provocation paper called DAO Woe, DAO It With Others. And she had been like doing really like early thought experiments with programmable money, like with once Ethereum came online after Bitcoin. And she was saying, like, why don't we try and do DAIWO, but with DAOs? Let's formalize it. Let's build smart contracts around it. Let's actually organize using the blockchain, on the blockchain, make smart contracts, make it happen. And it was a classic example of someone having an idea, me going, yeah, let's do it. And then, like, not being able to put the commitment down, no matter how hard it was, how impossible it was to do, how much sense it didn't make, this kind of provocation really stuck with us. The reason it didn't work was because the tools weren't there for a start. The tools weren't there for a really, really long time. And thinking with tools is actually a really good way to work in community. So I think one of the reasons that I talk about the stress of this work is because we, for many, many years, we were talking about something where, in the hype, in the kind of world of blockchain hype, it was all about how the world was completely different now because of the blockchain, and anyone could do it. Whereas in the actual world, this ecosystem didn't exist. It was all vaporware. It was all promised to get VC money. And so, like, it was actually quite hard to kind of work out what was happening for quite a while. But what we did was we ran a series of labs. So the DAO labs were run initially as part of an EU-funded program called State Machines that we were involved with Inter. And Yanis and Helene here. And these were labs they were kind of themed labs to bring different design and artistic participatory practices to like really try and get in, like open up the black box, see what the relationship was between these kind of systems of radical organization that come from an art tradition of situationism, Dada, Fluxus, all of this stuff, and see what we might be applied in the kind of blockchain field. 2017, we published a book called Artists Rethinking the Blockchain. Mark was co-editor. And this turned out to be like ridiculous. We because of the networks we were in at Furtherfield, we were able to publish something kind of ridiculously early, actually, of artists who were making blockchain artworks, writing speculative fiction and writing theory on this field. So this is like 3 or 4 years before NFTs became a thing, but it actually became like, we are now the guys that wrote the book on blockchain art. That is actually a thing. And it's quite interesting, it's useful because it provides a theoretization that kind of counters the vaporware hype problem. So the Radical Friends book really kind of comes from these partnerships, the State Machines partnership, and then partnerships with the Serpentine Gallery's R&D platform in London, and amazing support from the Goethe Institute. I mean, this kind of support is like has been super important. So a kind of distributed cultural network that wants to connect people in different cities in the world, and they supported like quite experimental, quite niche work that people kept on telling us was either stupid, unethical, or like way too niche. And they kind of supported us to do this work, and I think I'm like super grateful to them for that. Just to come back to kind of like what this, like why translocality is important to blockchains, and then I'm going to give you a few examples of how this is kind of playing out. So translocal living, it kind of, working with the, thinking about translocality provides us, it kind of gives us the context, it helps me to explain why blockchain research seemed really important thing to do. It helped us to understand the kind of power of a technical protocol that that kind of presents a vision for planetary scale financial and governance infrastructure. So blockchains allow us to make our own money. I'm talking sort of, make our own money and do voting. Okay, so this is financial and governance infrastructure, peer produced, malleable, mutable, designed and operated by peers. So it has all the open source yumminess. It has all the peer production, like we make it as we need it, yumminess, with governance and money baked in. This felt like too interesting a promise not to explore. And across national boundaries, without oversight by states and banks. And that kind of DAOs especially really lent themselves to this kind of cooperative organization dream. Why art in the middle of this? Well, because art does help us to understand what these things can do, and it helps to make the kind of tools and concepts more accessible to more people, which means you can then discuss them and then you can critique them more easily. And you can do useful stuff with them. So these were really early examples of blockchain art. So 2017, we have Bail Block, the New Inquiry. So with this work, you downloaded the Bail Block app, and a small portion of your computer's unused processing power was redirected towards mining a popular currency then called Monero. So it's secure, private, and untraceable. So it does quite a combination of quite useful things. The funds were gathered monthly and then converted to dollars and donated to bail funds in the National Bail Fund Network, including Immigrant Bail Fund, which then released people who were detained under the notoriously cruel, racist ICE immigration regime. So it was a kind of active, it was an app that promoted solidarity and worked really well for quite a long time before kind of crypto peaks and troughs, and the amount of power it took to get enough money, it hit one of these kind of bell curve things. But a very, really strong project for quite a while. Then we have Harvest by Julian Oliver. So he describes this as critical engineering and computational climate art. So it uses wind energy to mine cryptocurrency, and then the earnings are used as a source of funding for climate change research. This was kind of resonating with growing concern about the excessive energy uses of Bitcoin, which is still a massive problem. So looking like it starts to really point a finger at kind of like what responsibilities we have as users of digital technology, who, if we are also concerned about environmental and CO2 emissions. ClickMind by Sarah Friend does this at the level of metaphor. So this is a blockchain-based clicker game. With each click, you can mine a virtual plot of land, and an ERC-20 token on the Ethereum network is minted, as well as buying various power-ups. She asked, what is a token anyway? And as wealth is created, it is also destroyed. So this is a game in which you kind of click, 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 click. You end up with a black hole. Huge amounts of the currency that is worthless to you. And this was kind of like, this was the only game she ever actually made on the Ethereum network before it moved to proof of stake, which made it a lot less energy hungry. And this was a game where you're literally destroying the planet and creating a black hole and paying to do it, but you're kind of getting these. So there's all this kind of like, it's engaging you in this kind of like mind-blowing process of like, what are we actually doing here? And then finally, bottom left-hand corner, we have Terra Zero. So this is a proto-DAO, really. It's set up as a self-owning forest. So the idea is humans buy a forest, and then they hand it over to, they give it over to the forest. They set the forest up as its own owner, and the forest then hires humans to service it, sell its timber, commodify it, look after its own health. The idea being that the forest gradually expands and becomes a kind of sovereign entity. So like really early experiments in the kind of sovereignty of natural systems and how that might kind of interface with blockchain. There are three whole talks in here about like there's so many problems with it, and so much. It's a really good piece to look down the microscope at all the things there are to worry about actually with blockchain and tokenization. Okay, so this is a image from a live action role play that we ran at the DAIWO lab with Ed Fornielis. It was called What Will It Be Like When We Buy an Island on the Blockchain? And this was weirdly kind of, it was like a weird, what's it called when you do something and then reality does the same thing? Anyway, that happened. And Brock Pierce, after we'd run this, kind of like went into some unholy alliance with the Puerto Rican government and bought up huge parts of islands of Puerto Rico and set it up as a tax haven. And this live action role play was set up to think about what kinds of political imaginaries sit within a world that is driven by crypto economies and cryptocurrencies. We had four people, four different islands that basically evolved over 50 years in a two-hour period. And one was highly anarchistic, one was highly libertarian and kind of transhumanist, one was a feminist. And these kind of evolved and grew, and it gave us a way to kind of think about what values might actually be embedded in the technical infrastructure and what that might actually produce. And so I'm using this as an example just to say, like, why are we focusing, like, what value does art bring to this debate? Well, I think it allows us to explore real world. It allowed us to explore real world early crypto cultures and their tendencies. It allowed us to explore a web where the values of money itself are really explicit rather than hidden as they are in Web 2. And to build the capacity for kind of critical resistance in the face of colonial extraction. That might be really hopeful, but that was our intention. It continues to be our aspiration, like finding modes of resistance, basically. So how have blockchain technologies appeared in the art world? Well, they've appeared like cryptocurrencies. Let's say this is kind of like digital money. I'm not doing the full explainer. It's kind of like digital money is all I'm going to say. And this impacted in the art world in that for a short while, there was really a lot of money sloshing around and people needed places to spend it. NFTs, non-fungible tokens, are like certificates for digital property. So in art, NFTs serve to make digital files scarce. So when NFTs start, it's like, whereas before a file was like infinitely reproducible and you could distribute it and it near to no cost, now you can say, this file is a unique file. And here's the certificate that's attached to it. It also separates ownership from copyright. There's way too many kind of like each of these has a like that actually changes things. But I think we just need to say it and then we can forget it. I think NFTs can make art market and financial dynamics more visible, explicit, and malleable. So we can start to see what's happening and you can start to mess with it a little bit. But DAOs are where we're going to settle and end. These are peer-built member organizations run through systems of proposal and voting. Now, they've often been about new ways to do business in an unregulated field, very much oriented to profit, so you get unregulated shell organizations, basically. But they are also, in their setup, very well suited to experiments in new translocal cooperative organizational forms. Let's just think about DAOs for a moment longer. So the software of the DAO manages membership, it manages the pooling and the distribution of resources according to the pre-agreed rules of its members, and it keeps permanent and transparent records of all decisions made. So this is the kind of core, like, these are the core functions that I think make it, they're like really boring to say and think about, but when you start playing with them, I think it's where like interesting things can start to happen. So they're organized around member ownership and rights. You're encoding relationships between all stakeholders in the production and organization of resources and community. So this is like, you can really work this stuff on commons principles, which has been a kind of a fascination and a commitment at Further Field for really a long time. I just want to like make a note, like, why did we call a book about decentralized autonomous organizations in the arts Radical Friends? Like, why is it based, framed around friendship? Well, so it was our response to seeing like this kind of feverish generative creativity that happens around decentralized tech seems to make people forget what's important and to forget that they're really propagating, potentially universalizing systems that might be really harmful. So our idea with focusing around friendship is that friendship feels like one of the least harmful universal principles, like in really in all societies that we know of, even in even in creature societies. Friendship is it's a kind of motivation to care for people who might be in a different, who might have different needs, different conditions. It motivates us to use our resourcefulness to like really think about how we can create shared well-being. Like, not only that, but if we, once we commit to the well-being of friends from different backgrounds, it alerts us to the need for better strategies to counter patriarchal and colonial control, like through institutions of state, religion, corporations, like, so all of these things, like, which really control what kinds of relationships we're allowed to have, what rituals we must participate in order to belong, and how our behavior is to be restricted and the penalties we'll face for transgression. So coming back to Ty Selassie's rituals, relationships, and restrictions, like if we focus on creating infrastructures that support us to think in that way, our assertion is that it will help us to make better global infrastructures if we're really thinking on the principles of friendship. So I'm going to finish with a real focus on what we think DAOs can do. So by putting cultures based on friendship and care before structure and economics, relationships, rituals, and values can really start to shape the infrastructure. I think it's interesting, I really like this from Kia Kreutler. She says that we can think of Artworld DAOs as executable Artworld manifestos. So like we think about what it is that we are asserting, and then we think about these kind of DAOs or organizations as ways to template tools or contracts that can like start to reinforce these, make them so. They support us with the experiments with commons principles of transparency and trust in decentralized systems. We can really overstate that, but again, like worth thinking about. And it brings critical attention to the impact that money and finance has in the art world and beyond that on living systems. So I'm going to finish just by talking about some different forms of art world DAOs that we've seen. So an early one was the Fingerprints DAO. Now this, the Fingerprints DAO, like really worked on the art world model. It took high concept blockchain art, so artworks that used smart contracts to do concept. So like it Ria Myers, Harm van den Dorpel, the kind of art that I actually really love. So it's like it's doing kind of critical reflexive work on how the smart contracts themselves are changing relationships using smart contracts. So there's kind of very neat, kind of concise work. And generating these huge treasuries that would then be controlled by its members. This very quickly just turned into a collection that is about asset management. So it immediately turned the art into an asset. And I put this up, it's worth digging into this, like it's such an interesting trajectory. It started out about the art, it really has ended up about assets. Maybe it was always about assets. It was probably always about assets. I'm always way too hopeful. The Nouns DAO, I've put in as a kind of more community, potentially community-oriented version of the PFPs. So like there was this whole series of like, I can never remember what it stands for, pictures for proof or profile pics kind of things. So an early one of these was the CryptoPunks. But Nouns, basically, it produces a kind of auto-generated image, like usually a cute picture of some sort, and then it auctions it every day as a way to build membership and generate treasuries. And here, the current bid, this was taken yesterday, the current bid on Noun number 673 was 22 ETH. ETH is currently worth about $2,000. So every day, right now, they're generating, someone is buying one of these NFTs for the equivalent of nearly 50 grand to either gain membership to this membership DAO in order to decide what to do with the treasury. And you need to have two nouns to be able to vote, to be able to propose that something that people can then vote on. And there's a whole raft of things that people are kind of proposing. So they might be proposing an artwork, they might be proposing a development of the software, they might be proposing all kinds of things. Go and have a look at it. Again, it's I just think it's an important mechanism for us to understand what's happening here. And it's plutocracy, right? So you need money to buy, to vote, to participate. And then at the bottom, these are two much more artistically driven, more kind of commons oriented. So the Sphere was an early EU-funded Artworld DAO that really unusual, I think. It was a crypto company comes together with circus people. Circus people are very underfunded. They want to be able to commission new experimental work. And they created this project called the Sphere. And what they're doing is that they're taking seminal circus works, and then they're voting on which of these seminal circus works should be taken and taken as appropriated and remade. And then I think they were really banking on being able to attract the same kinds of crypto investors as Fingerprints and Nouns DAO. And I think they misjudged it. So I don't think they were getting the $40,000 a day into their treasury. But they got a little bit of it, and they did commission like three or four new circus artworks. And so they're kind of like, this is a bit of a proof of concept. And then finally, there's a project that I've only just learned about recently with by Winnie Soon and Su Tung Lee. And this kind of like reimagines oceanic autonomy in the South China Seas through a kind of queer hackerist ethos. And I find it quite outlandish. I can't get my head around what exactly it is they're doing, but it's a very community, it's a kind of bottom-up, slightly kind of metaphorical project to own the South China Seas and to decide what should be done with it before the Chinese state gets ownership of it, or before other states can come to take ownership of it. So it's like land or seas that aren't already owned, let's take ownership of it by tokenizing a milliliter at a time. And I can't quite understand what's happening there, but I feel like it's interesting. So there's two projects that we're working on, then I need to stop. So we're looking at building art world DAOs that center care, which means beginning with translocal communities with a common cause or need. This image is just to say the projects we're working on all are like, these are made with people in places, okay? So the last two, this is Black Swan DAO that was initiated by Penny. This works on some research that she did in Berlin, which was where she was hired by the city of Berlin to kind of like do an analysis or an audit of the art world ecosystems and the health of the art world ecosystem in Berlin, where she discovered that funders, venues, institutions were holding all the resource and all the power, and they would kind of distribute money to artists or designers, but that then those artists and designers would get the benefit, but the ecosystem didn't get the benefit. So the ecosystem was often kind of like left depleted when its kind of members were favored. And so Black Swan DAO invites resourcing from these institutions, and then it has membership, an artist membership community that does proposals and voting on how to spend it. So then they are enriching their own ecosystem as well as making work that needs to be made. And last of all, Culture Stake is a project that we've been making at Furtherfield. So this has been like really grown from our place in the park, and it's to build collective cultural decision making using quadratic voting on the blockchain, which allows everyone to vote on the types of cultural activity they'd like to see in places that matter to them. So QV allows people to show the intensity of their preference as well as their preferences. Blockchain gives a kind of transparency and tamper-proof result, so whatever people vote for, we can't say they didn't vote for it. And together they kind of create a transparent data about what matters to people and places. I've gone on too long, I need to stop. So here it is in action. I can talk more about it to anyone who's interested later. And this is my ending statement. So our kind of core idea is that we need to move away from small groups of experts making decisions for large groups of people towards large groups of people working together as translocal cultural communities in places that matter to them. I'll stop.